And I suppose one thing I'd like us to poke at a bit more as we start that discussion is this question of the extent to which Brexit is a sort of disruptive hinge point in these debates, or whether essentially it's sort of business as usual, albeit in a somewhat different context. I mean, several of the speakers in different ways, and I felt were pushing quite strongly towards an argument of continuity in many respects, but there are, of course, you know, distinguishing features in the evidence policy landscape as a result of Brexit, not least the kind of mundane and practical expertise, evidence, regulatory gaps that are going to arise as the UK withdraws itself from various pan-European structures or agencies. So, I mean, particularly thoughts or questions on that, I guess, to start us off, and then we'll sort of move into other things. Anyone want to chip in? If you could sort of introduce yourselves when you ask a question, that would be good as well. I think we've got a roving mic over there. Who would like to kick us off? Yes, here. You've got a microphone here.
I'm Paul Hutchins from UWTSD, and my question was basically that. Is there a danger that Brexit becomes all the ultimate confounding or extraneous variable to so much of the research? To all of you, I suppose, or anybody that wants it.
Okay, let's hold. Let's just see if there's a few more maybe in this kind of area, and we can come. Anyone else? Yeah, Jasper.
Hi, Jasper Montana with the University of Sheffield. I just wanted to also introduce the issue of the media, because I think Brexit came around at a time when social media and the sources of where people are getting their information, their evidence, which does impact on public perceptions, public, but also policy, creates policy windows for some changes. So I was just interested in the potential contribution of changes in media, kind of dissemination of evidence, and how that might impact.
Yeah, no, that is a good point, because that clearly is something, I mean, not particular to Brexit, but certainly particular to the last 8-10 years that has changed, and is also, of course, very much part of the Trump phenomenon. Yes.
Quite a naive and general question, but a lot of us are researchers and we know about evidence, we care about evidence. So what a lot I've been hearing is that sort of in the policy, in the political space, it seems to be that there are ways of getting around the evidence if you have a good story. And my question, which I put on Twitter, is that as people that understand a bit more about the importance of evidence, how do we ensure that the stories, the powerful use cases, reinforce the evidence rather than detract from it?
Yeah, no, that is a good question. Shall we come and deal with those, and then we'll come back for a sort of second round? Paul, do you want to? I mean, the.
Yeah.
Any or all of those three?
I suppose I've only got an answer for the third one. So I was recently at a sort of storytelling workshop, and people were discussing, well, a few things. I mean, for a start, they were discussing two roles of storytelling. I mean, so one is the sort of thing we were interested in, I think, which is the kind of impact side of it. You know, tell a story to make some kind of change. But the other was, you know, storytelling as a sort of empowerment, as, you know, you tell a story to articulate who you are and what your place in the world is. And so, but I suppose there's a lot of storytelling happens without a kind of instrumental side. But on the instrumental side, I suppose the interesting thing was, I guess there are things you could predict, but one would be we're not quite sure which stories work and why, and therefore it's very difficult to answer that question, because the evidence on the impact of good stories is quite thin. So there are some good examples where so someone did a randomized controlled trial on comparing a public health simple information with a story that went with it. So that was what they were trying to do. And so they found that they had three groups, and one was, you know, they got a story on its own, they got the information on its own, or they got both. And I guess you can predict it was the group that got both that took most messages on. So they know that. But then at the end they said, well, you know, but the problem is we're comparing this with an information campaign with our story, and we're not particularly good at doing it, you know, particularly skilled. And so you know, the sort of the best evidence out there on the instrumental side comes at the end with this thing, well, we're really not sure what we're doing. And there was a similar sense, I think, from other colleagues that said, well, we're pretty sure that if you're telling a story on something like climate change or something like that, you're much better going with a hero story than a villain. You know, romanticize climate change people and demonize companies. But then if you look into, I mean, how many studies, I think, would you want before you were comfortable with acting on that basis? I don't know, it would be quite a few, I guess. And, you know, they're sitting on a 3, say. So there's lots of advice out there about how to answer that question, but it's fairly new and fairly thin.
Thank you. That's good. It's useful. Catherine, on that? Or?
The only thing I'd say is that I can't think of any policy decision where there would be the one piece of evidence that would make it really clear what to do. I think it's always going to be more complicated than that. So, you know, in the Brexit debates, there was lots of stuff about immigration on social media, as you pointed out. And the thing is, for some people, there's an obvious answer to what that, you know, what the policy response should be. The response should be, for instance, closing the borders. But for other people, the obvious policy response should be increasing international aid and solving problems in, you know, other countries. There is never going to be consensus over how to frame the political problem in a way that makes it obvious what the deal breaker bit of evidence is going to be, I think. And that's why we need to have discussions about priorities and values as well as the evidence base.
Hmm. And Warren, I mean, you've done quite a lot of work on social media and climate change and other. I mean, how much is it the game changer in
Well, I guess that, I mean, there's a lot of focus on consensus in climate change, it always has been. And I think from certainly some of the psychological work around identity and climate change, it's fairly clear that in certain countries, particularly in the US, for example, there's simply no way you're going to get everybody to agree about various aspects of climate change. Even if you could persuade everybody about the basic physics of it, getting people to agree about responses would be, or trying to get everybody to agree about a particular response would be somewhat self-defeating. To kind of go to Jasper's point about the role of social media in kind of disseminating info more generally, I thought there was a really interesting example with the Grenfell Tower disaster last week, I think it was, yeah. Very quickly, so the day after, I mean, so that was in the headlines, sort of first thing in the morning. By late morning, various kind of general journalists and even kind of climate change people who are following on Twitter, there was a very live debate about what some of the causes might have been about of disaster, both in terms of people were talking about the cladding already, but there was also a discussion about the motivations for that cladding being installed. And it was very interesting. You got a very interesting mix of people pitching into the debate. You got access to a lot of, you know, people were finding very obscure planning and policy documents very quickly and making them available. And although some people who I spoke to didn't like the fact that this debate was going on, as they were saying, while the tower was still on fire, essentially. Compared to how that would have played out 10 years ago, I mean, the amount of information and, you know, good quality information that was available to people was quite stunning, really. The amount of sense-making that was going on was phenomenal. And you know, there was a lot of, obviously, emotion and political arguments mixed up in that as well, and some of the actors were playing up certain aspects of the policy and the potential motivations for the cladding being put on, which did fit with their kind of more general world view. But I thought that was a really good example of how social media can really kind of help people put evidence together. So I'm quite keen, I mean, it's particularly thinking about climate change, people think about social media as this kind of, you know, I don't know what a polite word would be, but not somewhere where you'd imagine sense making to take place. You know, it's very polarized, people chuck insults at each other, etc., etc. And that does happen, of course, with some people. But you know, it's also really, it can be a really rich source for actors getting together and talking about issues very quickly, in very timely fashion.
Yeah, I mean, to your response, in terms of consensus and climate, I mean, part of the phenomenon of social media is its ability to rapidly create and maintain micro consensuses that deviate from the meta consensus. So, I mean, in climate science, you've got the scientific consensus as embodied in the IPCC reports, but on Twitter or you know, Facebook, whatever, you've got strong, self-identified and constantly reinforced, rapidly responding communities of people who have their own deviating position. And that does seem, it does seem to me that is a new element of the landscape we're operating in. But of course, there were always, you know, minority positions in these debates, but the way in which they are maintained at very rapid cycles among different communities is rather different. I mean, not just on the right, but obviously on the left as well, around you know, these sort of new, you know, the Canary and all these sort of alt-left sites as much as alt-right sites. Anyway, enough of mine. Yeah. Jane.
I think on the social media point, we definitely saw that, for example, blogging, as I mentioned, so academic blogs as a site for academics to sort of talk directly to policymakers in a way that they might not have been able to do before. I definitely had clerks from the House of Commons saying to me, blogs do two things for me. They, one, tell me that an academic knows about a subject, and two, they tell me they can talk about it in a way that normal people can understand. So that was something that was very strongly felt within Parliament. Also, to remember that parliamentarians have no access to journals, none. So the only research they get is the stuff that's freely available, and blogs have been a way to make that link between research that's out there and policymakers. The point on whether Brexit is going to sort of influence all of our research plans for the next however long years, I'd just say to remember that the timescales between what parliamentarians need and what how long it takes to get research projects going is so completely different. They need responses now. And so that's why I was talking about sort of wise counsel. People, academics having to sort of think about, yeah, I know none of us know what's going to go on, but how do I kind of think from experience in other countries or it's going to go? Because by the time we all get our research grants and do the stuff, we'll be out potentially. You know, so the timescales on this are really difficult, and I think that's something that, you know, when we're all considering how we respond to that, yep, is something that we need to think about. ESRC has started to do, I think they call them emergency grants, or completely really need them now grants, which was to try to respond to that. They did it around the migrant crisis to sort of help academics to very quickly start to produce work. And they funded things like the UK Changing Europe programme, which was a group of academics who already had very strong backgrounds in particular areas to be able to sort of not do new research, but to synthesise research for these, you know, over the period since the referendum. So those are the kind of things that are happening within the academic community, and it would be interesting to see whether that actually has an effect to sort of help policymakers through what's obviously going to be a very challenging time.
No, thanks, Jen. And I mean, Britain and the EU and the Menem programme has just funded a whole round of these sort of rapid ESRC Brexit-focused projects, which are precisely intended to do that. I mean, just also to pick up on your open access point and to give a plug, as it were, to our hosts. I think, you know, so in my role as a sort of impact advocate in my own university, people are often still very surprised to be told that you know, the level of access to journals, paywall journals in Whitehall and Westminster, is, in, you know, just virtually non-existent unless you happen to have a researcher who's still got a, you know, password from their time at university. And you know, people are unaware, which is one of the reasons why journals like Palgrave Communications are, I think, valuable interfaces in their own right. You know, for particularly topics that are very policy relevant. You know, if you've got like this debate here, that, you know, the collection Paul's editing, I did one on science advice for the journal as well. So, that landscape is, of course, changing across the piece as research funders of various kinds also make open access a requirement. But it's much easier to access journals that are entirely OA and where there's not even any complicated sort of process of getting access to stuff of any kind. Sarah, any thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with Jane really on the sort of Brexit dominance point. What I think policymakers in Parliament and government need now is sort of its translation and synthesis of existing knowledge more than new research programmes, although I'm sure there are many fruitful future research programmes to keep us all busy for 20 years. The concern I have actually is more that the slowness of the government machine, I think, to respond to what I would see as a pressing need for expertise, and the fact that we've only just seen a CSA, the Chief Scientific Advisor, advertised in the Department for International Trade, for example. Still no real clarity on how DEX-EU is going to, you know, take account of scientific and other expertise. I think that's more concerning. It's the slowness of the government machine to sort of realise the need. And again, Parliament's probably ahead of that in some ways. Because MPs are trying to find out more and think about how they can enact their sort of scrutinising and holding government to account role. On the stories point, I think it's quite simple. I think we have to accept that stories are a powerful way to communicate, and if you can frame evidence in some sort of narrative or story way, it's more compelling. And actually, one of my favourite reports on this, which Jonathan Brecken, had he been able to come, would probably give a plug to, is the Alliance for Useful Evidence project on what works for the use of evidence in policymaking. And one of the main findings of that was of the importance of framing your evidence, of using stories, and of thinking about clear communication. So I think that's probably a fact of life, but it's also true that it's not about one individual piece or one earth-shattering research paper. It's about how you weave it together. As a synthesis of evidence. On the social media point, I am an acknowledged technophobe who doesn't use social media, but I did hear on the Today programme this morning a headline about the Reuters report showing a decline of trust in mainstream news media and a corresponding increase in people using social media to access news, which did make me think, you know, goodness me, what does that mean for newspapers? And also, what does it mean for those academics that think of newspapers as a way of communicating with the public? And maybe we are now going to see a shift to more sort of online platforms. Things like The Conversation, which features academic-based journalism, or Jimmy Wales' new initiative to try and have sort of credible fact-based journalism that was then crowdsourced. So maybe actually what you're looking at is some sort of new informal partnership between experts and traditional media and new forms of media and online dissemination, which could be really interesting. I don't know how it will work, and I don't know how you get away from the idea of setting your academic up as, you know, the expert who knows more than anybody else, versus the mood of social media, which I think is much less hierarchical and rigid.
I was wondering if you could reflect, everyone in the panel, on the role of individual personalities from academics. So there's a couple of schools of thought. There's one which I have a lot of sympathy for within climate science, which is that scientists should not be talking about policy because it undermines the science, because then you come across advocate rather than a scientist. But I also remember in the run-up to the referendum, a number of times where there'd be some kind of, like 100 economists wrote a letter, and that would be reported as 100 economists, faceless. Then there would be one person from an economist for Brexit or whatever, who would be named and would then speak. And that person then became, you know, an individual with a face and you know, a comment, who could then be
emotional attachment. That's good. Name, could introduce.
Sorry, it's George Adamson from King's.
Right, yeah, just easy for us to respond. No. Get your name as well. Good, thank you.
Hi, Justin Parkhurst from the LSE. I think I have concern with how we're talking about evidence use here. I value the panelists very much. I've read enough work from many of them, and I really find their work great. But I have a fear that we've equated good evidence with evidence that has effect and evidence that's taken up. And and that's a theme that's either been explicit or implicit in a lot of the statements. So Catherine mentioned we need to start giving people the evidence they need. Warren, maybe I misinterpreted it, but you kind of concluded by saying we need to combine ideas and arguments and data to be effective. But effective in what way? Paul, you talked about the cognitive biases that we face that affect how we interpret evidence, but then you seem to conclude that we need to therefore play to those biases as opposed to, for example, to overcome them. My take on this, and something I've worked on as well, is that we need to build systems that ensure improved uses of evidence, not necessarily try to encourage individuals, researchers, or even whole bodies to get their evidence into policy. It leads down to a route that was mentioned in terms of advocacy, or what Roger Peel in his book, The Honest Broker, would talk about stealth issue advocacy. As soon as we start trying to get a piece of evidence, our evidence, even if it's robust and rigorous, we are biasing the agenda to the findings that it leads to. And so if we're talking about improved uses of evidence, I don't think we could equate that to necessarily evidence that is taken up or has impact. For me, there are two normative principles at stake here. One is scientific good practice and scientific fidelity. We want to make sure that the bodies of evidence that inform policy are robust, systematic, high quality, and rigorous. But in policymaking, there's another important normative concern, and that's democratic representation, accountability, the multiple social values at stake, that those are being represented transparently. And so the final points made about including the public and co-production for me is a step towards that if you start talking about multiple social concerns being represented. But there's a risk when we start conflating that, when we start saying that the public are experts too, without saying experts on what. Michael Gove, if you kept going down his quotes, then started saying the people are the experts, listen to themselves. Now the people are not experts on macroeconomics, right? But he's responding to the fact that the IMF and the Bank of England came out with economic predictions. And his response was, well, the people are experts. No, they're not. Not from macroeconomics. They're experts on values. They're experts on what matters to them. They're experts on their multiple concerns. So we need that distinguishing. We need that delineation between certain things that are solvable by science, certain things that are perhaps modeled by science with risk, and then there are things that have to do with democratic principles and representation. And I worry that those are being conflated at times, even in this panel, which is incredibly nuanced.
No, thank you. That's a good, healthy corrective to that danger, Justin. Thank you. Just behind you there, yeah.
Hi, Carl Allen, I'm a pensioner. If you're curious, my country is not as advanced as England. When we say post-Brexit, what are we talking about? That period, not only with the EU, owns the land for housing, which is a great problem in England. Automation, robotics, aging. So, talking about a rather long period, what I'm wondering is how will people involved in evidence begin to collect all their resources, not only talk of one issue every time, multiple issues, have multiple impacts. When all of that going to be done at a rapid fire pace?
Thank you. No, that's useful. Yes, just their point.
Thanks. I'm Ben Hawkins. I work at the London School of Hygiene. My question was sort of principally to Warren and also sort of little. Catherine's presentation as well, and there was something you said towards the end of your presentation, Warren. I think you sort of attributed to Carol Weiss about good evidence is a sort of weaving together of ideas, arguments, data. And one of the interesting things to come out of the discussion so far is the concept of evidence itself and what we mean. And I wonder if there's a sort of danger. Some of the discussions that the concept of evidence becomes sort of stretched to the point where it's no longer useful, because a lot of what was sort of presented as being sort of evidence or good evidence could, you know, was representing something that could equally be described through other labels that I would use in sort of my work, through discourses or framings and things like that. And I wondered if there's something like particularly evidentiary about evidence that we're missing here with these broader and more inclusive interpretations, which in many respects I'm sort of in favour of and can see the advantages of. But is there something about evidence, maybe linking back to Justin's point about expertise over what that kind of differentiates some of these other things that we might talk about?
Great, thank you. We take one last, any final questions? No, we've exhausted the. There's a fair few to get through. We'll go the other way back down the panel. Sarah, we'll start with you. Don't obviously pick from among the board.
You're absolutely right about good evidence isn't always the evidence that's used. I don't think anybody would dispute that. And there's plenty of examples, God knows, from our politics. I think that is part of the pragmatic, practical reality we deal with at the moment. And however much we might want to work towards a more systemic use of good, robust evidence and a greater use of that as a sort of deciding factor in policy decisions, we're not there yet. So I think it's both that we have to work towards what you're describing, adopt the honest broker role when we can, but also accept that there is a sort of a practical, pragmatic reality which is less than ideal. And that perhaps speaks to the question about individual personalities as well, in that actually I think in the reality of doing this, in my experience, and I used to work actually as a researcher for an MP, so I've been a bit on the other side of this, is that you are influenced by trust and individual relationships, and actually policy impact isn't really, you don't go and have impact on Parliament or on a government department, you go and have impact, if you're lucky, if it works, on an individual who works in Parliament, an individual MP or a staffer or a civil servant. So I think we have to recognise that actually a lot of this really does come down to individual relationships, and then it's how those individuals then use the knowledge, the expertise, the evidence that they're gaining. And the other thing is politicians are always going to be driven by their own values, by powerful stories from their constituents. The three MPs I worked for, their approach was basically, this is what matters to my constituents, so now we'll try and find the evidence. But it was very rarely, let's find the evidence and then sort of look for the stories. There was always that emotional impulse, I think. So I think it's working towards the ideal, but we have to be quite pragmatic. And that's probably true. It probably speaks to the point about the muddling through as well. When things are messy, that is the best you can do. None of this is a perfect world with perfect outcomes. The role of universities, I suppose, is to make sure that we are leaving room not just for the research that is fashionable and that is quickly taken up by policymakers, but the research that is challenging existing streams of thoughts as well. And perhaps they are unique. We are unique institutions in having still, for now, the capacity to do that.
Thank you. Jane.
I'll try and tackle three very quickly. I very much like the description of puzzles, problems and messes. I think that's a really evocative kind of set of things. And I think partly what I think we found in our research on social science disciplines especially is to try and sort of, at the very first step, help politicians think about which of those they're dealing with. So it was, quotes like, social science helping create a commonality of language so that people could even start talking about the issues, but also helping people to even try and work out what questions they should be asking that you could then go on and try and find some research around. So I think there's something about helping policymakers to even frame the discussion around which things are puzzles and which are problems and which are, the messes, you probably know what they are, but so I think there's something about that even before you start thinking about the policy making bit, to even just sort of look at the landscape, and I think that's something that's very important. It doesn't always get covered so much in literature. I think the point about individual personalities is really interesting. When we were working, we worked a lot with academics who were thinking about impact, and a lot of them say, I don't want to be that media don, I don't want to be that person on the telly all the time, because it's not very respected within academia, and I think that's something that we sort of have to think about. We're also pushing people out who, especially on social media, it's not a terribly safe place to be as a sort of opinionated woman, for example. So I think the support that researchers need, if we're encouraging people to be that talking head, whether in mainstream media or social media, is something we really have to think about. And I think we've all been sort of challenged a bit by how some of the big broadcasters reported Brexit in exactly the way that you say, you know, with 100 on one side. If it's the same with climate change, you know, there's sort of consensus around it. I think it's a very good point about post-Brexit Britain and how we, you know, how we try and handle that. Some of our problem is around the timescales. As I was saying, academic work takes quite a while to get going. But I think there's something that when you have worked in Parliament, you can see how closely MPs are to their local community. They do actually have to sit and talk to their constituents quite regularly. And so they are able to see more, I think, about how things around, as you mentioned, automation of jobs, but also how local environment is developed, land, as we mentioned. So I think they are more able to see some of the complexities of policy and how they may need evidence on these topics that talk to each other in a way that some policymakers in government bodies don't. And we definitely did work with MPs about complexity. We had these things called postcards. That we're trying to give a picture that you would build up by creating these sort of set of pictures around postcards that really try to talk to that, the complexity of some of these issues and how some topics that seemed quite distant were actually having a real effect on people within their constituency. So I think that's something that I would hope Parliament was able to do in a way that might be quite interesting and useful.
Thank you, Jane. Warren, there was a specific question.
There was, thank you. I'll just tackle Justin's point first. So I mean, I do agree. So I think so I should make clear, when I was talking about different types of evidence, I wasn't talking about a particular researcher providing all those. These are different inputs that could come from different places, which politicians, policymakers need to assess, and didn't have time to go into it there, but I would certainly endorse the idea that we have particular systems, and I've written before about kind of ways of governing different types of knowledge in ways that are more transparent. So I would certainly go along with that. In fact, I was sat with someone this morning who made a very good point about impact case studies and the idea that we should all be pushing our own particular types of research without much consideration of whether actually that's the best research to be pushing, and the fact that, you know, the research is trying to generate these impact case studies could actually be quite unethical if we thought in the back of our mind that maybe this isn't the right intervention for this particular policy area. And then the other one that was directed to me, so about the idea, is there something particularly evidentiary about evidence, if you like? So I should make clear that when Vice was kind of writing, I think it's directly applicable to evidence-based policy, but when she was writing, she was actually talking about policy research was actually the exact phrase she used. So I think what I didn't have time to talk about in the presentation was when she talks about these three different types of evidence, she talks about how the amount of influence they have varies according to the different circumstances. So if you do have a lot of consensus within a policy area, and it's not really an area, it's quite a kind of technical area, and there's not a lot of values at play, then that is when data is really, really important. But if it is an area where values are, there's a lot of dispute over values. I mean, a classic example in the States would be something around the science around abortion policy. You know, there's a lot of research around that, but when it's come down to it, I mean, people like Dan Sarovitz have shown quite convincingly that, you know, there's a lot of technical research that goes on, and there's a lot of data that's put into it, but ultimately the decisions that are made seem to be quite value-based at the end of the day. So I think there are but these types of evidence, I mean, we can have a discussion about whether evidence is the right way to talk about them, and I do completely accept the idea that you don't want to make the term so elastic that it becomes meaningless. But I think by giving it a little bit of elastic, we bring in the fact that, you know, hard scientific data or quantitative data, whatever kind, is not always going to win the day. That's really the point I'm making. I hope that helps. And I'm very pleased to hear muddling through getting mentioned, because I think that should, I don't see much room for that in kind of, you know, Newsnight discussions, whatever, at the moment. But that should always be the watchword.
And finally, Paul, a couple of parting shots.
Okay, I've got a quick one and a longer one you'll have to cut me off with. So the quick one is, I thought when you talked about the personalities of scientists and that sort of thing, I thought what you were leading up to was that there are a lot of academics with particular personalities that shouldn't be allowed anywhere near policymakers. You know, they'll just make things worse. And there is this brilliant paper, I mean, I couldn't give you the exact details just now, but this brilliant paper on GM scientists that I'm paraphrasing, but pretty much says they're doing more harm than good in public because they're just pissing everyone off. They're just saying the public's too stupid to understand GM, so, there's something gone quite wrong there. It's the wrong kind of impact. The longer one is, let me try and connect muddling through with Justin's point. I mean, I agree with you. I am very deliberately saying that we should adapt to these biases. And I think that it's part of this interesting broader debate about the way we describe cognitive biases. So you've got, I guess we've now got this association with Kahneman and other people that essentially describe cognitive biases negatively most of the time. You know, these are the things that cause people to make the wrong decisions. But there's this other kind of body of work that says instead, you know, that marvels at humanity and the ability of people to make fast and frugal decisions, turn a complex world into action in, you know, phenomenal ways. And I think that's the sort of thing we're trying to sort of tap into, to say that policymakers often come up with very efficient ways of doing politics. And, you know, as non-specialists in politics, it became arrogant of us to go in and say, well, let me tell you how to make your processes more scientific. And I think people have been trying that for about 50 years and getting nowhere. And so I suppose my basic point is, what do you do when you're waiting for this major transformation in government to happen when it won't happen? Well, you adapt to what's there instead. And I think that is where the kind of muddling through phrase came from. So it's a great example of impact, because I would associate that with Charles Lindblom, who came up with this phrase in the 50s and then the 70s again. And it still hangs around, even though if you look at policy studies, the most scientific body of work in policy studies kind of contradicts his kind of argument. You know, I mean, that's the kind of nerdy point. But his brilliant sort of analogy, I think, was between the difference between what you should be striving for, unaided human flight, or the other one, airplanes and stuff. You know, so one is going to take you along a very impressive route where you can fly all sorts of places in an airplane. The other is going to leave you old and diminished and give up at the end when you realise the thing you want you're never going to have. You know, I mean, I think that's what I would say. You know, if a lot of this is adapting to things we don't like, but you deal with it as efficiently as possible, or you're just going to end up very dissatisfied with life.
On that cheery note, we will draw things to a close. Please do stay and continue the conversation over a drink and some food, which will be available outside now. If your appetite has been piqued beyond the nibbles on offer, and you would like to contribute to Paul's collection, I believe he's still open for submissions and offers. It'd be good to get more submissions coming forward in and around these debates over Brexit and evidence and policy as part of that. Finally, it just forced me to thank, firstly, our hosts, Gino, Jessica, and colleagues here at Palgrave. Thank all of you for coming and contributing to what's been a very interesting discussion. And finally, please do join me in thanking our five panellists, our six panellists, because we mustn't neglect the star panellist. Like, I think every panel should be, you know, improved by having a baby on it, really. That's my big take home from this afternoon. But no, join me in thanking Paul, Catherine, Warren, Jane, and Sarah.